welcome to Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle. In this lecture, we will discuss the sublime, the profound, the historic apparition of Our Lady of the Rosary at Fatima. Now, in our previous lectures regarding Marian private revelation, I've mentioned that you don't want to compare Our Lady in one apparition to Our Lady in another apparition and have somehow Our Lady beat out Our Lady. Obviously, it's not a competition, and this entire Marian message to the modern world should be seen as one message, one unified message from one mother to contemporary humanity, which, as we've mentioned, admits of different emphases and different cultural expressions. At the same time, the apparitions of Fatima, according to many commentators, should receive a certain precedence, a certain predilection, if you will. Why? Because all the apparitions in this age of Mary, starting with the miraculous medal onward, seem to lead up to the Fatima message. And all the apparitions, authentic apparitions of Our Lady, that take place after these apparitions in 1917, seek the fulfillment of what is revealed at Fatima, which is the call for the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. So we can say there is a certain dignity, a certain sublimity, and even a certain precedence, preeminence with Fatima that deserves some special attention. So we're going to seek to synthesize what is a very extraordinary message and even a volumeless event. A Filipino ambassador, a Vatican ambassador, Ambassador Howard D., went to Cardinal Ratzinger in the early 1990s and said to Cardinal Ratzinger, at that time who was the prefect for the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, asking, why is there not an encyclical on Fatima? And Cardinal Ratzinger reportedly responded to Ambassador D., well, to write an encyclical on Fatima would be like writing an encyclical on the gospel. And if we keep in mind, as we previously discussed, the purpose of private revelation, it is never to replace the gospel, but to lead to a more generous living of the gospel. So with that in mind, let's enter the Fatima message. Now, as we talked about the apparitions of Lourdes in our last lecture, we talked about a general call of prayer and penance for the two goals of, one, the vertical goal of reparation to God, and two, the horizontal goal of the conversion of sinners, or what we can call Christian co-redemption, our efforts offered for our brother and sister who, and for their salvation in that dimension of humanity. Well, Fatima will continue that same theme, but we'll get much more concretization, much more specificity in how we continue that call of reparation and co-redemption. For example, at Lourdes, we heard a general call of penance, penance, penance. At Fatima, Our Lady of the Rosary will say, make of everything you can a sacrifice to God and offer it to Him. Also, we'll have a general reference of reparation in Lourdes. Here, and really in an extraordinary way of putting it on a universal ecclesial map, Our Lady will call for devotion to her Immaculate Heart. And we'll even get more specific and talk about five first Saturdays of devotion to her Immaculate Heart with the goal of reparation, of offering reparation specifically to the heart of Our Lady. And our Lord so encourages this, as He also speaks on this particular December 10th, 1925, mystical experience, this apparition, that He offers, along with Our Lady, in this, not only the conditions for fulfilling these first Saturdays, but also, as Our Lady will then underscore, the promise of salvation, the graces necessary for salvation. Remembering, of course, Lumen Gentium 62, that Mary intercedes for the gifts of eternal life. And she will do so powerfully and profoundly at Fatima. But once again, There are six messages at Fatima, six principal apparitions, properly said, going from May 13th to October 13th, with the promise of yet a further manifestation. And there's actually a few further manifestations, but we're going to focus on the further apparition that we'll discuss the five first Saturdays. You're talking about apparitions that take place in Portugal in 1917 to three Portuguese shepherd children, Lucia, who will be the primary visionary, Jacinta, and Francisco. Ages when the 1917 apparitions happened, ages 10, 7, and 8, respectively. And in that context, it's important to note, although, again, we don't have time to enter this in our introduction class, there are three very beautiful angelic apparitions to the three visionaries that prepare for the 1917 apparitions of Our Lady. I encourage you to look into these three angelic apparitions, two in 1916, the third in early 1917, because they very much resemble in their theology what we now pray as the Chaplet of Divine Mercy, this act of offering consecrated Jesus, the Eucharist, as laity, exercising the priesthood of laity for reparation and, again, for co-redemption. And this will be very much anchored and underscored in the Divine Mercy Chaplet. We're offering the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ, already consecrated because, of course, those outside of ministerial priesthood can't consecrate, but they can still exercise their priesthood of the laity in the process of making that offer. So I just want to read one of the principal prayers that was revealed that reflects this by the guardian angel of Portugal, Saint Michael, who is the one who delivers these three introductory apparitions. Just note the theology of the prayer that the archangel asks the children to pray for reparation. The first prayer: My God, I believe, I adore, I hope, and I love you, and I beg pardon of you for those who do not believe, do not adore, do not hope, and do not love you. And then that's followed by the revelation of the prayer: Most Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I adore you profoundly and offer you the most precious body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ, present in all the tabernacles of the world, in reparation for the outrages, sacrileges, and indifferences with which he is offended. And through the infinite merits of his most sacred heart and the Immaculate Heart of Mary, I beg of you the conversion of poor sinners. So once again, we don't have time to really untap the wealth of these two prayers and the theme of Eucharistic reparation, but I want to make reference that even before it's revealed by Jesus to St. Faustina, it's revealed in kernel, in essence, in these 1916 and going on to 1917 angelic apparitions, which prepare for the six great apparitions at Fatima. But once again, it would not be difficult to offer a 10-series course on the Fatima message and its effects, but we have to remain succinct. And so I want to just focus on what is arguably the single most important message of the 20th century. And that's the message of July 13th, 1917. This is the message where Our Lady indeed establishes that it's God's will that devotion to her Immaculate Heart would take place as a remedy for a vision of hell. And I want to read to you that message, even though it will take us several minutes, because once again, arguably, it's the single most important message. It also predicts a potential conditional Second World War and the fact that the Holy Father will have much to suffer, and even that which many contemporaries and commentators would say have yet to happen, the annihilation of nations. So once again, because of its importance, I want to read to you the July 13th, 1917 message from Our Lady of the Rosary, as recorded in the memoirs of the principal visionary, Lucia. And I quote, "A few moments after arriving at the Cova de Aria near the Holmoke, where a large number of people were praying the rosary. We saw the flash of light once more, and a moment later, Our Lady appeared on the holmok. What do you want of me? I asked. This is Lucia. Then Our Lady. I want you to come here on the 13th of next month to continue to pray the rosary every day in honor of Our Lady of the Rosary in order to obtain peace for the world and the end of the war, because only she can help you. Sacrifice yourselves for sinners, and say many times, especially whenever you make some sacrifice, O Jesus, it is for love of you, for the conversion of sinners, and a reparation for the sins committed against the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Our Lady spoke these last words, as Our Lady spoke these last words, she opened her hands once more, as she had done during the two previous months. The rays of light seemed to penetrate the earth, and we saw, as it were, a sea of fire. Plunged in this fire were demons and souls in human forms, like transparent burning embers, all blackened and burnished bronze, floating about in the conflagration, now raised into the air by the flames that issued from within themselves, together with great clouds of smoke, falling back now on every side like sparks in huge fires, without weight or equilibrium, amid shrieks and groans of pain and despair, which horrified us and made us tremble with fear. It must have been this sight which caused me to cry out, as people say they heard me. The demons could be distinguished by their terrifying and repellent likeness to frightful and unknown animals, black and transparent like burning coals. Terrified, and as if to plead for succor, we looked up at Our Lady, who said to us so kindly and sadly, "You have seen hell, where the souls of poor sinners go. To save them, God wishes to establish in the world devotion to my Immaculate Heart. If what I say to you is done, many souls will be saved and there will be peace. The war is going to end. But if people do not cease offending God, a worse one will break out during the pontificate of Pius XI. When you see a night illuminated by an unknown light, know that this is the great sign given you by God, that he is about to punish the world for its crimes by means of war, famine, and persecutions of the Church and the Holy Father. To prevent this, I shall come to ask for the consecration of Russia to my Immaculate Heart and the communion of reparation on the first Saturdays. If my requests are heeded, Russia will be converted and there will be peace. If not, she will spread her errors throughout the world, causing wars and persecutions of the Church. The good will be martyred. The Holy Father will have much to suffer. Various nations will be annihilated. In the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. The Holy Father will consecrate Russia to me, and she will be converted, and a period of peace will be granted to the world. When you pray the rosary, say after each mystery, O my Jesus, forgive us, save us from the fire of hell, lead all souls to heaven, especially those who are on most need. Now, that's a slightly edited version. The full July 13, 1917 message has even more details. But let's go to these keynotes. Let's summarize this incredibly important message in a few highlights. First of all, Our Lady identifies herself as Our Lady of the Rosary, and she calls for praying the rosary daily in order to obtain world peace. Now, keep in mind, this is taking place during the third year of World War I, a devastating war. And so Our Lady is emphasizing that the praying of the rosary is not just for personal sanctification, it's for global peace. It has that supernatural capacity. Our Lady also mentions, she uses the expression, because only she can help you. Now, that would encourage the interpretation that the plan of world peace has been given by the Most Holy Trinity, who's obviously infinitely concerned about world peace as well, but this task has been given specifically to Our Lady. And that's the importance of us focusing on this Fatima message in response to her words. Now, later in the message, Our Lady will speak about the intentions by which to offer a sacrifice. And she will say, offer a sacrifice out of love for Jesus, for the conversion of sinners, and in reparation to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. So those three themes will also be prominent in terms of what we're supposed to offer our sufferings for. Number one, once again, love of Jesus. So the vertical dimension is first, we're offering consolation and reparation to Jesus. Number two, the conversion of sinners. There we have our Christian co-redemption again. And three, and this really becomes a foundation of the Fatima message, reparation directly to the Immaculate Heart of Mary for the offenses she has received in ingratitude and blasphemy. Much more detail on that as we get to the December 10th, 1925 message. Then we have the vision of hell. This obviously conveys the reality of hell and that indeed people are in hell, which is a basic Christian assumption, but the reality of hell is, of course, certain. Now, some have theologically speculated, well, we know that there's hell, but we don't know if there's anybody in there. That, I think, could be considered a less fruitful speculation than what we get through Fatima, which is indeed a revelation, private, though authentic, that there are people in hell, and that hell is a real possibility, and therefore the message. After the vision of hell, she immediately says, God wishes to establish devotion to my Immaculate Heart. So we have the vision of hell, the reality of hell, the reality of people in hell, and then the remedy to stop what would be this experience of people entering hell. Yashinta would later say that due to sins like the sin of impurity, people were entering hell like snowflakes. And again, all of those have to be seen in light of a proper theology as the Magisterium puts it forward. But it's clearly a Marian remedy for the reality of people in perdition, in the sense of people going to hell. Of course, once a person is in hell, that's a permanent eternal state. But it's to, of course, prevent and to lead to conversion. That's the keynote of this Fatima message, that it's God himself who wishes to establish devotion to Our Lady's Immaculate Heart. Well, then we have a series of prophecies about Russia spreading her errors throughout the world, prophecies of a potential Second World War under the pontificate of Pius XI. Now, that's interesting because Our Lady is even prophesying the name of the future pope. These are all happening, these apparitions, during the pontificate of Pope Benedict XV. And the reference of the Holy Father having much to suffer and even various nations being annihilated. Then we get the great promise, known as the Fatima promise. In the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. The Holy Father will consecrate Russia to me, and a period of peace will be granted to the world. And we'll talk about where we are in that scenario when we talk a little bit about the third secret of Fatima, but I think most of us would agree that we are not presently experiencing an era of peace. There is great moral degeneration, natural disaster, wars, rumors of wars, and certainly not a global living of the gospel on any means. The third, this July 13th message ends with the tale, if you will, the final prayer we put after every decade of the rosary. Oh my Jesus, forgive us our sins, save us from the fires of hell, lead all souls to heaven, especially those in most need. So notice the mercy message of Fatima, which again will be juxtaposed to the divine mercy apparitions, which will happen within a few decades. Now, at the end of the July 13th message, there is what is called the third secret, or the third part, along with the vision of hell, the call to establish devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. There is a third revelation, which is not revealed initially, and as we'll talk about shortly, it's not revealed until June of the year 2000 by Pope St. John Paul II. Let's go on to the October 13th message. Once again, all the messages are eminently worth reading, and I encourage you to read all the messages from May 13th through October 13th. The only message that doesn't happen on the 13th is in August, and that's when the young children are taken away by local authorities and threatened with death. And then that apparition actually happens on August 19th, which is the feast of St. John Eudes, which is the great promoter some three centuries early of devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary. So let's go through now the October 13th message with the historic event of a solar miracle. Again, from Lucia's memoirs, October 13th, 1917. The words of Our Lady, quote, I want to tell you that a chapel is to be built here in my honor. I am the Lady of the Rosary. Continue always to pray the Rosary every day. The war is going to end and the soldiers will soon return to their homes. Lucia, I have many things to ask you, the cure of some sick persons, the conversion of sinners, and other things. Our Lady, some yes, but not others. They must amend their lives and ask forgiveness for their sins. Looking very sadly, Our Lady said, do not offend the Lord our God anymore, because he is already so much offended. Then opening her hands, she made them reflect on the sun, and she ascended. The reflection of her own light continued to be projected on the sun itself. After Our Lady had disappeared into the immense distance of the firmament, we beheld Saint Joseph with the child Jesus. And Our Lady robed in white with a blue mantle beside the sun. Saint Joseph and the child Jesus appeared to bless the world, for they traced the sign of the cross with their hands. When, a little later, this apparition disappeared, I saw Our Lord and Our Lady. It seemed to me that it was Our Lady of Sorrows. Our Lord appeared to bless the world in the same manner as Saint Joseph had done. This apparition also vanished, and I saw Our Lady once more, this time resembling Our Lady of Mount Carmel. Now, after this revelation, let me say a few words about what is in the message and then the phenomena that will follow. She appears in three different visions. One is with the Holy Family. Saint Joseph and the Christ Child blessed the world simultaneously, which I think probably underscores the role of Saint Joseph, who is the universal patron of the Church, in the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. If the Church is to triumph, clearly that will be through the intercession of the patron of the Church, Saint Joseph. Secondly, Our Lady appears with Jesus and her revelation as Our Lady of Sorrows. Well, that is the devotional expression of Our Lady as co-redemptrix. Her seven sorrows reflecting the seven ways in which she participates with the sufferings of Jesus for the world's redemption. Thirdly, she appears as Our Lady of Mount Carmel. She has the scapular in her hand. Commentators have speculated that that would represent in three images the joyful mysteries, the sorrowful mysteries, and the glorious mysteries, which of course indicated by the scapular, which has its promise of salvation. Then we have the solar miracle, witnessed by 70,000 onlookers, published by two reporters from the Lisbon paper who lost their jobs because indeed they reported a miracle to a Masonic-run newspaper, at that time a Masonic-run nation. And there's the experience of the sun dancing, as is described by the onlookers, giving off colors, looking like a silver disc, and then coming to the ground, coming to the earth, leading people to prostrate themselves in the wet ground, since it had been raining through the morning. When the sun returns to its position in the sky, the ground is dry, which underscores some true physiological dimension to this miracle. Well, let's move on to the apparition, which will describe the five first Saturdays. So we go to December 10th, 1925, And during this apparition, Our Lady is now appearing to Sister Lucia of the Immaculate Heart in a convent in Spain. In between that time, Jacinta and Francisco both died of the what was called the Spanish influenza before 1920. And great reparation was done by Jacinta. Francisco, who in an earlier message, when Lucia asked if the children were going to go to heaven, she said, am I going to heaven? Our Lady said, yes. Jacinta, yes. And in responding to Francisco, Our Lady said, yes, but he will have to pray many rosaries. Well, that was certainly an impetus for this young man, this really nine-year-old, to pray the rosary almost continuous for the rest of his life, which would be a short life, ending with his death before 1920 due to the influenza. Let's go to this December 10th, 1925 message. Again, this is Sister Lucia writing in the third person, as was the style at the time, talking about the five first Saturdays. And I quote from her memoirs. On December 10th, 1925, the Most Holy Virgin appeared to her, Sister Lucia, and by her side, elevated by a luminous cloud, was a child. The Most Holy Virgin rested her hand on her shoulder, and as she did so, she showed her a heart encircled by thorns, which she was holding in her hand. At the same time, the child said, so just so we're clear, Our Lady, she takes her heart from her chest and holds it out, but it's Jesus who speaks first. The child says, and I quote, have compassion on the heart of your Most Holy Mother, covered with thorns with which ungrateful men pierce it at every moment, and there is no one to make an act of reparation to remove them. Then the Most Holy Virgin said, look, my daughter, at my heart, surrounded with thorns, with which ungrateful men pierce me at every moment by their blasphemies and ingratitudes. You at least try to console me and say that I promise to assist at the hour of death with the graces necessary for salvation. All those who, on the first Saturday of five consecutive months, shall confess, receive Holy Communion, recite five decades of the Rosary, and keep me company for 15 minutes while meditating on the 15 mysteries of the Rosary with the intention of making reparation to me. So this, my friends, in Jesus and Mary, becomes the foundation of the first of the five first Saturdays devotion. So once again, both Jesus and Our Lady identify that Mary's heart is in constant suffering, mystical suffering, due to the ingratitude of man and blasphemies from humanity. Now, as a very quick theological aside, one might say, well, how can Mary's heart be suffering if Mary has the beatific vision and she's in heaven? Well, it is true that Jesus and Mary as the head of the body and Our Lady as the mother, as the neck of the body, but really a mother of the church and of all humanity, have the, quote, privilege to continue to mystically suffer until the salvation of her children for Our Lady and the great work of redemption in history has been accomplished. St. John Vianney has the well-known quip of saying, Our Lady will have no rest until her children get home. And so in that sense, Our Lady can continue to suffer mystically, even though she has the beatific vision, because we know that Jesus, while on the cross, had the beatific vision, but still obtained the redemption of the world through his suffering. So this is part of the mystery of suffering with the beatific vision, but we have the clear precedence with Jesus himself. So what the message says, and this, quite frankly, is underscored throughout Marian private revelation and mystical writings from the saints and the blesseds, that Mary experiences an ongoing mystical suffering because of the sufferings of her children. And in the 1930s, the spiritual director of Sister Lucia asked Sister Lucia, why are there five first Saturdays? Why not seven or three? And Sister Lucia received from Jesus directly the five offenses which most offend Our Lady's heart. And as revealed by Jesus, that would be number one, the denial of her Immaculate Conception. Number two, the denial of her perfect and perpetual virginity. Number three, denial that she's Mother of God and spiritual mother of all. Number four, the desecration of her images. And number five, when little children are led astray from her. So these constitute the major modes of offending and causing suffering to the spiritual mother of over 7 billion people right now. And we can even look at how many of people alive today do not acknowledge Our Lady as Mother, and in fact have committed elements of these five offenses, hence the five First Saturdays. What is required to obtain the five First Saturday graces? Once again, as specified by Our Lady, that any five consecutive First Saturdays, so one could start on any First Saturday they desire, but for five consecutive First Saturdays, to number one, receive Holy Communion, number two, to receive sacramental confession, and that can be within 8 days, in some jurisdictions, even 2 weeks from the First Saturday based on availability. So reception of Holy Communion, sacramental confession. Number three, the praying of the Rosary, five decades of the Rosary. Number four, Our Lady says, to keep me company while praying the 15 mysteries. And that is, number four emphasizes the necessity of actual meditation. One might think that three and four are redundant, but the reality is many people pray the Rosary on only a vocal prayer level, and Our Lady wants meditation as an essential part of this. So with, and of course, in cases of serious sin, we would have confession before reception of Holy Communion. With confession, reception of Holy Communion, five decades of the Rosary, and then keeping her company with 15 minutes of meditation, all of those must be done with the intention of making reparation to Our Lady's Immaculate Heart. For that, as you heard, she promises to be able to intercede for the graces necessary for salvation. This is not unlike what we talked about with the scapular sacramental, but most of all, Mary is the mediatrix of all graces. And whether one understands that in a sense of moral cause or intercession or physical cause, that is, as the great saints, de Montfort and Colby and Bernard of Clairvaux would say, that our Lord has given the jurisdiction of the graces of redemption to Our Lady to distribute as she wills, to whom she wills. And that's also a legitimate position within the Church, that she has the capacity to intercede for the graces necessary for salvation. And I want to go back just very briefly to the July 13th message, where the two requirements, the two requests bring forward the Triumph of the Immaculate Heart. Number one is the consecration of Russia to the Immaculate Heart, which we talked about in a previous program, that was satisfied, that it was accomplished according both to Sister Lucia on several occasions and also to St. John Paul, by St. John Paul II, was confirmed by him. So that, along with the second request, which is this, and that is the communion of reparations on the first Saturday. So this is an ongoing fulfillment of the Fatima message. Well, finally, I want to go to the third part of this of the message of July 13th, or commonly known as the third secret. As I mentioned, this was revealed on July 13th, 1917, from Our Lady to Sister Lucia, but it's not revealed to the world until St. John Paul II, on May 13th of 2000, when he comes to Fatima, when he goes to Fatima to beatify Jacinta and Francisco. At that moment, it is announced that within the next couple weeks, and it would happen in June, the release, the public revelation of the third secret of Fatima. So let's conclude by examining that third secret of Fatima and examining also its relevance to us today. Again, as it was revealed, quote, after the two parts which I have already explained, this of course is Sister Lucia, at the left of Our Lady and a little above, we saw an angel with a flaming sword in his left hand. Flashing, it gave out flames that looked as though they would set the world on fire. But they died out in contact with the splendor that Our Lady radiated towards him from her right hand. Pointing to the earth with his right hand, the angel cried out in a loud voice, penance, penance, penance. And we saw in an immense light that is God something similar to how people appear in a mirror when they pass in front of it, a bishop dressed in white. We had the impression that it was the Holy Father. And other bishops, priests, men and women religious, going up a steep mountain, at the top of which there was a big cross of rough-hewn trunks, as of a cork tree with the bark. Before reaching there, the Holy Father passed through a city, a big city, half in ruins, and half trembling, with halting step, afflicted with pain and sorrow, he prayed for the souls of the corpses he met on his way. Having reached the top of the mountain, on his knees at the foot of the big cross, he was killed by a group of soldiers who fired bullets and arrows at him. And in the same way, there died one after another the other bishops, priests, men and women, religious, and various lay peoples of different ranks and positions. Beneath the two arms of the cross, there were two angels, each with a crystal aspersorium in his hand, in which they gathered up the blood of the martyrs and with it sprinkled the souls that were making their way to God. Now, that is certainly a very symbolic message. I would just offer a few thoughts in terms of, I think, an authentic interpretation. One is that Sister Lucia identified the man dressed in white as the person of St. John Paul II. And clearly, an event that would be relevant to this would be the assassination attempt on St. John Paul II. Now, this, along with the purpose of prophecy, I think helps us to understand the great relevance of this message for our own times. Remember, the purpose of prophecy is where God reveals something concerning the future for the sake of conversion. There was one principal interpretation which seemed to suggest that this third secret only referred to the past in the sense of even the communist torture and persecution of the church in places like the Ukraine. That would seem to indicate that the whole purpose of the prophecy was lost because the prophecy isn't revealed until decades after that in the year 2000. I think a more foundational interpretation would be that which was given by Pope Benedict XVI on his way, as he was on his flight to Fatima, when he confirmed that events happening in our day and age, and this was back in the early 2000s, were still part of the fulfillment of the third secret of Fatima. As I mentioned before, unfortunately, in terms of being able to put it into the past, the realization of the annihilation of nations has not yet taken place. There's been the renaming of nations, there's been the restructuring of nations, but annihilations of nations have not happened. And I want to close with one thing that Cardinal Ratzinger said when he released this secret. First of all, that there's no official interpretation by the church of this third secret, and therefore there is legitimate license for a variety of interpretations. Secondly, he said, we have within our own nuclear capacities the possibilities of fulfilling the worst of the third secret. So I think all of this could encourage a prayerful examination that the message of Fatima remains quintessentially relevant to our own day, and that there are still elements in the future that could be very much the fulfillment of this Fatima message. I conclude with the final comments of Sister Lucia in an interview she made in 1919 when she said the following to the founder of the Blue Army, John Hafford, in an interview, that the first stage, the first day of the week of Fatima, as she put it, was the day of the apparitions. She then said the second day within a week, the week of symbolic week, right, of Fatima, was the pre-consecration period. She then said, we're now in the third day, which is the post-consecration period. She then said, rather mysteriously, there are still four more days of the message of Fatima. And that would, again, given in 1999, she would die soon after that. That gives us, I think, further encouragement to realize the message of Fatima is a message of efficacy, of relevance, and of a real summons for us to live this message today, including the praying of the rosary, including the first Saturdays of reparation, and the Christian co-redemption of making everything we can a sacrifice and offering it to the Most High God. Well, thank you for being with us in this lecture of Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle saying God bless you all, and let us all strive evermore to accept and to live the great gift in appreciation of what Jesus gives us all from Calvary. In his words, behold your mother. God bless.